Today I'm going to talk about GPU.JS. It's a library for general purpose computing on the GPU in the browser. Okay, a little bit about me. This is my username, Fazli360 on GitHub. I don't have a Twitter account. I work at Garena, all-around hacker. I like to think of myself as a GPU and JavaScript enthusiast. Well, JavaScript is one of my first languages that I learned, so it holds a special part in my heart. If you want to check out my blog, I have live JavaScript. I have interactive JavaScript demos there, and go ahead and check it out.
I'm Eugene. I go by the username Pico Creator, be on Stack Overflow, GitHub, Medium, and a few other places I can't even remember anymore. I'm a founder of two startups. Pico.Private Limited, so a web and mobile application development company, HTML5, Web 2.0, you know the typical sales drill. And currently, UIlicious, which is creating a fast and robust UI testing engine, because maintaining Selenium scripts is a painful and labor-intensive process. And this project, is actually championed heavily by Faz, because he is the one that is at the heart of it in terms of the GPU knowledge, and I'm just here supporting him along the way. The story behind GPU.JS is actually kind of an awkward hackathon story, and we actually enjoy telling it because of what happened throughout our experience in it. The too long didn't read of GPU.JS is a GPU accelerated JavaScript. It was made with four people, and somehow the four people's image is not appearing. Okay, never mind. But in 24 hours, NUS hacked in row 2016. And the story spoiler is that we came in second. So, special thanks to Matthew and Julia, who are the other two members of the team, who is not part of this conference today. Okay, and the thing about the GPU.JS that is special to us is that it had a rather Nintendo fun start, in the sense that while we had the idea about 4 months prior to the hackathon competition to do an API similar to jQuery and CUDA, because Faz was extremely excited about CUDA, and we wanted to do this for our hackathon. Our team was notoriously playful, only meeting for pizza and games. And every time we met, we were like, let's win this, let's start preparing next week. Because all our previous hackathon, we end up playing more Wii U rather than doing anything. And next week, went on to next week when Mario Kart came out, and eventually Hyrule Warriors also came out. And yeah, next week, pretty much end up to things didn't go as planned. So this was literally our detailed master plan by the time the hackathon started. We take in JavaScript, somehow with some GPU.JS voodoo magic, and we output WebGL code. So much awesome. And that caused us to actually end up doing this in literally 24 hours. 12 hours before the event, I even forgot about the event, and Faz called me, "Dude, tomorrow is hack and roll." And when we finally got the event started on the 23rd Jan 2016, we started after wasting time with swag and food as every other hackathon. A few hours later, we got our basic libraries in. That was WebCR and GL, which we eventually removed, and a broken JSON, which we found out later that it was broken because our Hello World wasn't even working, and this was at 12 a.m. So we were getting our basics, and nothing was working, which is eventually sanity went out the window because it's kind of depressing when you can't even return a line by 2 a.m. And what do we learn from all this? Well, for one, bring a really huge screen at a hackathon. People will keep coming over and asking you, whoa, what's that ridiculous huge screen? Other than that, never do a compiler for a hackathon. Like, seriously. 2 a.m., like I said, Hello World is not even working, and you'll be questioning your sanity. 4 a.m., when we finally got Hello World working, which was just a return 42.0, we eventually got our basic math compilation working, so this is like 1 plus 1 at 7 a.m. And the worst part was that it was slower than the CPU, which completely destroyed our main value proposition of the project. And after spending a lot of time in optimization and coffee, thanks to Jimmy Monkey as well, back then, two hours before the end of the hackathon, we finally got our speed up. And that was mainly because we finally added support for for loops, which actually changed the computational complexity for our demo. The outcome of it? Somehow we managed to get 1,000% plus benchmark out of it. And this was for a computational intensive formula. So in our math part, highly parallelizable, GPU, the GPU better than CPU formula, which is a scenario of your managed may vary depending on your data size and function, because, like seriously, this benchmark is only that fast, and your code will never be this fast. And all this is now open source at GPU.JS in GitHub and GPU Rocks, the website. Real-world applications, however, for this, after the project was finished, it's currently being tested and used in teaching a class in parallel computing, or more like it's already completed. And that, so, okay, what happened after, soon after, was that it's kind of semi-exploded across the internet. It got redeeted in Japan for some reason, and so, it mostly spring off users in university-based project work. And it's strange because people was like tweeting on disturbing us on it, and I had absolutely no idea this would happen. And the weirdest part was, I have no idea what the Japanese were using for it, but they keep asking me a few questions, and I did not understand nuts. And other applications was like, as one guy put it, using it for password cracking or Bitcoin mining. That was his wicked idea, which I actually replied. So did we. We actually wanted to try, give this a try, but we actually never had time to get it done in the hackathon, so we were like jokingly saying, maybe we'll do it next year. And at the end of it, we actually managed to put all the GPU.js into one convenient API package, which is as simple and straightforward as including the package, a single JavaScript file. It doesn't have it. It includes all the dependency in it. And then in JavaScript, you initiate new GPU. You get your options object. You define your dimensions. Your dimensions represents how big of an array output that you want it to be. This can be multiple dimensions. And you can create your kernel from there. So this is pretty much the simplest kernel that you can create, other than perhaps return 42. And and after that, you can just execute it like any other JS function and get your output. You have alternative building patterns. And you can use numeric inputs to pass the values onwards to modify your output. And you can alternatively even use it to render canvas images. This is through the get canvas mode. And that'll be for how to get started with it.
Well, a lot of people ask me, how do I access the hardware in your computer, the GPU itself? Well, the way we do it is we access it using this API called WebGL. I'm pretty sure you heard of WebGL. It's part of HTML5, and you can draw pretty pictures with it. So if I can describe WebGL in one sentence, and a kid can understand it, WebGL only draws triangles. You cannot draw squares. The only thing you can draw is literally triangles. It supports, it's actually OpenGL ES1.0 under the hood. That's very old. Does not support modulo operator. Does not support bitwise operators. Does not support for loops of random size. Although we did implement it in our compiler. It does not support any other data type other than integer. Single point floating, single position floating points. The API exposed to the developer on the HTML5, it appears synchronous, but in reality, it's asynchronous in the sense that the other thread is running on a GPU, obviously. So when you call get pixels, for example, it will blocked on the browser side, and there's an implicit synchronization going on. And you cannot run it in a web worker, so it's impossible to make it asynchronous. Nobody really writes WebGL programs these days. If you are writing a 2D application, most people use pixie.js. If you're writing a 3D application, there's 3.js. And if you're writing a shader toy, there's this application called, there's this library called ReGL. The main reason for this is writing WebGL is very painful. Nobody, it's like writing assembly instead of C. Okay, so since Eugene did the compiler, I will let him explain how the compilation is done.
So how does this work under the hood is that it takes in your JavaScript. So you, taking this as an example, it reads it into an abstract syntax tree. And at this point during the hackathon, we were using JSON, which is based off Bison. So one of the ridiculous things is that we were using a JSON compiler to compile a compiler for our GPU.JS that is going to compile your JavaScript to WebGL. Yeah, there was some compiler exception out there. And it's actually quite a pain to implement this because every single declaration that you do, be it a var, a plus sign, a minus sign, we had to write custom code for it to implement to convert that into WebGL. And your simple line here goes into a very ridiculously long tree that we eventually need to output into a WebGL code. And what started as 62 characters ends up as 4,215 characters.
OK, now we have our program. We compiled it. Where will it be? It will be at the fragment shader. This is part of the pipeline, one of two programmable units in the graphical pipeline, the other being the vertex shader. I'm not going to show the vertex shader because it's essentially the identity program, as in you pass in the data and it just passes the data along. OK, so first things first, we need to find a way how to get our data into the GPU. So for example, we have this array, 1 to 10. How do we put it in the GPU? Because we can't just send an array to the GPU because there's a limit to how much constants you can send to the GPU. And the way we do it is we use the textures in GPU and store this data. So how we do it, we segment it into channels, four channels. We segment it in this manner, red, green, blue, alpha, red, green, blue, alpha. You can segment it red, 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 green, 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 blue, 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 but we chose this manner because it was much easier for us. So you realize that the third color isn't a valid color because it's missing two components, so we just paired them with nonsense data. It could be anything. So in this case, we put zeros because JavaScript actually doesn't, you can't instantiate random data. I mean, you can't just claim data and not set it. Okay, so you have to realize that in GPU, in rendering, colors are in the range 0 to 1, but we are sending numbers that are outside this range. So we have to turn off the clam inside the renderer. And thankfully, WebGL has an option to do that. And we send something with a dynamic range of negative infinity to infinity into something that expects a range between 0 and 1. OK, so this is three colors. It's not yet ready to be transmitted into the GPU. It needs to be turned into a texture. So we have this 2D texture. WebGL, by the way, only supports 2D textures. So we have these 2D textures, and we squarify it. That means we make it a square, because that is the only way we can get the maximum density in a texture, because there's a limit to the dimension. We originally wanted 1 by the length of your array, but we discovered that it's silently clipped, unfortunately. So that's why we create a square. Okay, so now we know how to put data in. How do we get data out? Well, it's the same way. For example, we have this output array we want to write out. How our program works is in the shader, you will calculate the result and store it in the four channels. And we, in our particular case, we store it channel by channel. So we run your program, your kernel, four times. So on a GPU, we output red, green, blue, alpha. In four discrete steps, your GPU has output the entire array. But your CPU still only output four items. Well, this is an oversimplification because that's not how it actually works in the GPU. If your picture is very big, the they will segment like the picture and like and there's a lot of things, but it's a very long story, and that's is for another talk. So this explanation will do for now. But you realize that it's too long. There's two zeros at the back. Just clip it off.
Right.
Okay. We know a way to put our program in the GPU. We know a way to get data into the GPU. We know a way to get data out. How do we run the program? Well, it's simple. We just tell WebGL, hey, draw a rectangle on the screen, the size of the screen. Then you will tell me, hey, WebGL only draws triangles. You can't draw rectangles. OK, fine. Draw two triangles on the screen. OK. And effectively, you get something like this. That's basically rubbish. But you have tricked your GPU into doing your math homework. So these color pixels, even though they look random, they actually store your result of your kernel program. So in summary, if you want to sum up the magic in three sentences, your arrays are textures, your kernel is the shader, and the result is your screen. It can't be that easy, right? So there is some caveats. So in this code snippet right here, I know the return has to be in a function. Just imagine it's inside a function. First thing is branch divergence will cause a slowdown in the GPU. That is because every single branch will be executed on a GPU. It's just that the branch will not take effect. So if you have a if statement with 100 branches, well, too bad. You're going to run all 100 branches. Another thing, no floating point accuracy guarantees. No IEEE floating point standard guarantees. So if you have 1 divided by 3, multiply by 3, you might not get 1 again. And that's built into the standard because it wasn't made for this kind of computation. It was made for rendering pictures. Most people, when they look at this piece of code, they think there's only two branches, the then branch, the else branch. But actually, in reality, there is a Schrodinger's branch. It's the one at the bottom. Because the only way you get into that branch is if you do quantum computing or something, and you are neither here nor there. And sometimes you actually end up here. And I actually managed to get here on an Intel HD 2000, on a Chrome, on a MacBook. It's very specific. It's very rare. But the most important thing to note is like hardware may have bugs. And I don't know if any of you are still using Intel HD 2000. Well, my condolences, because it's pretty terrible. Okay, so and one more thing. Apparently, we use the GPU to also render our screen, and that's a very important task. So if your program takes too long, a watchdog will kill it, because it's not fair. Okay, so how do we actually go about writing our programs? So on GPU, we use this SPMD model, computational model. It stands for single program multi-data. So that means you use the same program to calculate different parts of the data. So as long as your program looks something like those two for loops over there, you can use our library to run the program. And the number of for loops is the number of dimensions, and f is your kernel, and it must be a functional function. Okay, so real example here, matrix multiplication, very classic. Always teaches. We always teach this in parallel computing. If you can see here, the kernel is right here, and if you want to turn it into a GPU.JS program, you don't have to rewrite it. Well, okay, you have to adjust a little bit here and there, but essentially all the stuff is right there already. Okay, so for this program right here, it's a 512 by 512 matrix, matrix multiplication, A times B equals C. We benchmark on a GTX 1080 with i7, 2.6 gigahertz. We got this amount of speed up, which is pretty good. 18 times faster. But to me, that's not the most important thing. It's actually more power efficient. Because if you check out the specs, although the graphic card consumes 4 times more power, it's 18 times faster. So very power efficient. I have another example over here. It's on, I mean, another benchmark on iPhone 7. Okay, so we can do this live. Oh, by the way, it runs on mobile devices because it's in JavaScript. Okay, so this is my iPhone 7, and let's run the benchmark. It takes a while because it takes multiple runs, and then like it shaves the offliers and takes the average and calculate the error. I'm running out of things to talk because it's taking too long.
The other survey that you need to take note is that generally, Nvidia cards work better.
Nvidia.
Yeah.
Okay. So anyway, quite impressive. 87 times faster. And you can see the GPU timing is almost the same as the CPU timing. The GPU timing is almost the same as the timing on the PC, which is, in my opinion, is impressive. Because look at the size of this thing. Look at the size of your desktop. OK, so how do I get back? OK, cool.
Eh? Yeah, you have to open the screen again.
All right, let's quickly go to the next one. OK, so we said earlier, right, we have to compile, we have to pass the program, we have to compile it, we have to send it to the GPU, we have to render our texture. There's so much overhead. How on earth is it faster? Well, the answer is math. Well, the time complexity of the matrix multiplication on GPU is just lower than on the CPU. So if you can see over here, the red line represents the GPU as the problem size grows. Well, it's quite flat, but the CPU is quadratic. So that's why when your matrix size is small, CPU is faster, but very quickly, the GPU makes up for the overhead. Another demo over here. These three demos, you can literally Google GPU.JS, Ray Tracer, you can find them online. Well, I'm going to show the first one because I want to show more things.
Which one you want?
Yeah, we killed it because we don't want it to take up resources. OK, so in this one by this fellow right here, he's a student in NUS, and this was a homework assignment. We used it a few months ago for a parallel computing course. OK, so you can select the resolution. You can select the amount of anti-aliasing. You can select the number of bounces of the ray. Ray tracing, by the way, is even though it's a rendering problem, it's still GPU because we don't use the graphics pipeline in the same manner, in a regular manner. Anyway, this is not running yet, 0 frames per second. Right, so there we go. You can see the reflections on the ball calculated live. 30 frames per second, huh?
It's probably being clamped by the HDMI cable.
60 frames per second, OK, cool. This is on the GPU, 60 frames per second. If we toggle this, we can toggle it because it's JavaScript, right? So this is on the CPU, 2 frames per second. Quite impressive, if you ask me. Slides to present. OK, demo gods was kind to us today. So anyway, 30 times faster on the GPU. Well, depending on your settings and your computer. Time complexity for ray tracer, not really interesting, but is there. So in summary, well, we made a hack. It was very painful. We made things do what they were not meant to do. And GPU, well, I just want people to know that, hey, it's here. You have literally supercomputers in your desktop. Last time, back in the day, we used Beowulf clusters. We put computers, we wire them together. You don't need that anymore. It's all in the, it's on your graphic card, and everyone owns a graphic card. And we use Java, I mean, we are using JavaScript. So you don't have to install anything. You can just run our library and write your program. And it's fast, it's power efficient. And I hope this talk piqued your interest in parallel computing or GPU computing. Well, if it did, please go and go out and learn more. For example, this book here, CUDA by example, one of the good books for CUDA, which in my opinion is the best GPGPU API out there. I know OpenCL runs on everything, but there's a price to pay for that. CUDA is the best one, and I'm not being paid by NVIDIA, by the way. Anyway, don't take our word for it for our benchmarks. Run it yourself. You can go to this URL. You can run the benchmarks. You can see the code is on GitHub, and you can see that it's legit. So anyway, one last thing. Hack and roll next year. Do join it. If you're a student from NUS, NTU, SMU, any from outside the country, please check it out. It's quite cool. So anyway, that's the end of the talk. If you guys have any questions, we love to take them right here. Do you have any questions? Okay.
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Well, we give you a microphone. Don't worry.
Not doing this one. Have you tried the a TensorFlow application with this JavaScript?
TensorFlow. So that's for machine learning, right? If I'm not wrong. Okay, we tried implementing machine learning algorithms, but so far, it's difficult because the capability of our library is not there yet because we only support certain syntax. Our JavaScript is a subset of the entire JavaScript, so we can't really support machine learning that well. But I mean, in the future, yeah.
I mean, to put an example, right? It's not only. It's currently on an experimental branch. If you want to check on the GitHub, it's only until last week or so did we add support for your binary operators, and
oh, you don't have to. Okay.
Your binary operators and be it for TensorFlow and a few other applications, these especially for when you're dealing with integers in particular, and you have to understand integers was not what the graphic card was designed for. Somehow it's just doesn't work that way, and we have to do a hack on top of it. And that was just last week. So, and this was actually in part because we were trying to support more complicated applications. Where was the binary operator?
Just leave it at the yeah. Okay.
And things like TensorFlow do require these operators. So we are actually exploring into a bigger range of usage. And as the requests come in, usually this is some university student asking, hey, can you do this? And say, I need that feature. Then we try to put it in. And when we put it in, then it's part of it. But TensorFlow probably will be a very too huge of a jump. So we are doing more incremental. So that's why now we are starting with ray tracers and parallelizing computing. Yeah.
Any other questions?
So it's on GitHub, right? People
yeah.
can
yeah,
do pull requests if you do a TensorFlow integration with that.
Yeah.
Maybe you make some students happy. We have time for one more question. Oh, yeah, that's going to be interesting.
Hi, a really cool project. My question is, are you using floating point textures to transfer the value? And when you're transferring from the pixel data back to, I believe, values in JavaScript, have you calculated what are the inaccuracies when doing these conversions?
I got bad news for you on one part. It boils down to your hardware. Because in general, NVIDIA gives you a better accuracy, but But your floating point accuracy by the WebGL specification, the high P is maximum 16-bit accuracy, was it?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, somewhere along the way. So if you want a high, if your accuracy, if you're happy with 16-bit accuracy of your floating point, then you probably can go safely along with most stuff except for Intel HD 2000. But other than that, if you need a higher floating point accuracy, you have to check down to your hardware. Normal and generally, basically, that rules out your mobile devices, and you are down to your desktop hardware.
By the way, if you're actually doing it for any serious purposes, use CUDA.
This is
more of a toy. Yeah. Not that it's a bad thing. Toys drive our future. I mean, like, students like go into computing because of toys. Like, I mean, for me, I picked up computing because of games, video games. I want to make video games. So, like, I thought that by making this easier, like, people can get into this. So, yeah, don't use our library for serious purposes, but, like,
education.
Yeah, it's just pretty cool. Yeah, it's education. Thomas?
Right.